Frieza Koyin-Lugo from Isipe. And this afternoon, my talk is going to focus on malaria transmission blocking potential of compounds isolated from this topic. And as a way of introduction, I'll start by giving a brief background of malaria, which is an infectious disease transmitted to humans by bites of female Anopheles mosquito. And according to WHO, close to 90% of malaria cases are actually reported in sub-Saharan Africa. And the reason why perhaps malaria is more intense in this region is because of the nature of the vectors that we find in Africa. Most of them have a lifespan that enable the parasite to grow and complete its life cycle within the parasite, and therefore can be transmitted to humans. And again, most of them, like Anopheles gambiae, prefer to bite humans rather than animals. And some of them also bite and rest indoors, which means that they have easy access to humans, which enhances transmission. So some of the methods that are currently being used to control malaria involve the use of vector control, and this was well covered in the keynote address. And vector control can be in form of IRS or treated nets. And then we also have the use of drugs that can either be used for prophylaxis or for treatment. So the key challenge to these methods of malaria control is mainly resistance, and this can be at two levels. That is at the level of the vector or at the parasite where you have resistance to existing anti-malarials. So again, that was also well covered in the keynote address, so I will not explain in details. But if you are to achieve the global goals of malaria elimination, we may need a new approach to complement vector control and chemotherapy. And so far, some of the new approaches that have been proposed involve the use of transgenic mosquitoes, or vaccines, for example, RTSS, which is currently undergoing clinical trials in Malawi, and transmission blocking drugs. So my work basically focuses on developing a malaria transmission blocking molecule. And this is basically how a transmission blocking molecule works. If you look at the life cycle of the malaria parasite, I had mentioned earlier that the parasite is transmitted by the mosquito, which means that we have a phase that occur within the mosquito to enable transmission, and another phase that occur in humans. If you look at most of the drugs that we have currently for managing malaria, most of them will target the phases that occur in humans, mainly because we are interested in treating the disease. Most of the time we neglect the stages that occur in the mosquito. So far, we only have primaclimitol has been approved as a malaria transmission blocking molecule, but it also has its own association with side effects, which means that for you to administer primaclimitol, you have to screen to ensure that the person you are administering primaclimitol to will not suffer from the side effects. Malaria transmission blocking molecule, therefore, is one that should target the transmissible stages of the malaria parasite and therefore prevent parasite transfer between the two hosts, that is either from humans to the mosquitoes or mosquitoes to humans. So for my research work, I'm interested in identifying a plant-based molecule that targets the parasites as it transitions from human to the mosquito. And my work is based on previous studies that were carried out at Isipe, where they were able to observe that if you have an infected female Anopheles mosquito, and you expose it to a number of plants, the most infected mosquitoes were more attracted to plants known as the starweed or parthenium. Parthenium generally is not rich in sugars, and mosquitoes feed on plants for sugars, mainly either for energy or for mating or for general growth and development. So if a mosquito is attracted to this plant that is very low in sugars, yet there are options of other plants that are rich in sugar, then it basically means that maybe it's going for something else other than the sugars. So to confirm that hypothesis, they carried out a second experiment, which was now a no-choice experiment, where the mosquito was allowed to feed on
this plant, and then after that they dissected the big gut, and then analyzed the content of the big gut, and they were able to isolate or detect a compound known as pathogen. So they argue that maybe pathogen, that maybe the infected Anopheles gummy mosquito feed on this plant to obtain pathogen. So to find out the role of pathogen in infected mosquitoes, they carried out another experiment in collaboration with the University of Florida in the US, and they administered pathogen to infected mosquitoes, and they were able to observe that actually the compound will block a certain stage of parasite development in the mosquito, known as the male gamete splagulation. So this is a male gamete when there is no intervention of pathogen. You can see it has what is known as the flagellar quotes or the gametes. And that is what you need to fertilize the female macrogametes. So if those projections are lacking, then it basically means that such gamete cannot fertilize the female, as shown in 2, 3, or 4, and which means that the zygote will not be formed during fertilization, and this can prevent parasite development within the mosquito. So they argue that pathogen is a potential malaria transmission blocking molecule. So the beauty of pathogen is that it belongs to the same class of compounds as artemisinin. They are both sesquiterpene lactones. And the lactone ring is this region over here. So while artemisinin is safe in humans and has been approved for medical treatment, pathogen is toxic to humans. And that is what limits its uptake in drug development or in malaria control. So to position this molecule for further uptake in drug design, I propose to modify its structure to improve its safety profile and, if possible, potency. So my key research question is, can you improve the safety profile of pathogen through structural modification? And to achieve that, I've isolated pathogen from the crude extract of the stawin, and this diagram basically shows the flowchart of how you can do that. And once pathogen was isolated, I used a method known as high-performance liquid chromatography to purify it further, and then analyze the content using chemical analysis tools such as GCMS, that is gas chromatography mass spec, and liquid chromatography, quadrupole time of flight mass spec, and nuclear magnetic resonance. I'll explain what those terminology mean in the next slide. So my target compound was pathogen. Pathogen is a mid-polar compound, which means that you can analyze it using either GCMS or LCMS. GCMS is for analyzing non-polar compounds, while the LCMS is for analyzing the polar compound. I'll explain why at times it's important to use both. So what you can pick up from this slide is the mass of the compound, that is like, for pathogen, the mass is 263 and it's well established and known, so you can confirm that indeed you isolated pathogen. And then again, what you see as peaks or the profile from the LCMS and GCMS are more like fingerprint, if I can use that loosely. So if you have another profile of pathogen as standard, then you can use that to compare and confirm that indeed you isolated the right compound. And different compounds will have different profiles. So you can use this more like your fingerprints to identify your compound. But these methods will not enable you to know the structure of a compound. So if you want to come up with the structure like I've displayed on the slide, then you may need an alternative method, which is NMR. So for those in the medical field, the principle behind NMR is more or less equivalent to MRI. So the same way you interpret images in MRI, you can interpret these images and then come up with the structure of the compound, and this will enable you to know, for example, why this hydrogen, for example, must just border a double bond, and maybe why you can't have the three hydrogens attached to the carbon, maybe here or here. So by interpreting all these images, you'll be in a position to come up with the structure. So my next compound of interest that I want to highlight is the hypopathogen. It's also a mid-polar compound, which means that you can analyze it by GCMS or LCMS. But now this compound, if you rely only on LCMS,
you can easily conclude
that it's a poor compound. And if you want to do preclinical trials or clinical trials, you can proceed. But if you use GCMS, you can see that it's not a poor compound. So this is an example of a racemic mixture, which is a compound that have same, which are two compounds that have same molecular mass, but they differ in their structural arrangement, like they are mirror images of each other. So again, a good example that I can give of a compound like this in the medical field is thalidomide. I don't know whether you have encountered it before. It was a drug that was approved for treating morning sickness in pregnant women, but then later on it was withdrawn from use. Why? Because one isomer can easily convert to another. And at times you may find that if it interconverts to a different isomer, then that isomer can either be inactive or very toxic, like in the case of thalidomide. So I had other compounds, but I'll only display the two. Chemistry is a little bit boring, so all you see are peaks. And my second objective was to modify the structure of pathenine. So in modifying the structure of pathenine, I imitated what was done for artemisinin. If you look at the derivatives of artemisinin, the main objective was basically to alter polarity, either increase or decrease. So for my synthesis, I increase polarity of the compound by adding an hydroxide group. This is more or less similar to what was done to dihydroartemisinin. It's a polar version of artemisinin. And then I also have another polar derivative of pathenine, but this time round I add a hydroxide group after attaching it to an oxygen. At times that is important, it can improve the activity. And a similar modification was done for artemisinin. Now to lower the polarity and make it more nonpolar, I added a methyl group. The nonpolar version of artemisinin is acetal. And in my modification, I targeted this functional group. You can see that in all of them, I was mainly targeting the double bond that is found in what is known as the keto ring. The reason behind that is that this is a double bond. It's a conjugated double bond. You have a double bond, single and double bond, which means that it's very unstable. So if you put this compound in a chemical environment, it will tend to stabilize itself. And in doing so, it might interfere with other biochemical reactions, especially if it is going to interact maybe with side groups of amino acids that form part of important biological proteins. So far, I'm yet to subject the compounds I've isolated and synthesized to determine their malaria transmission blocking potential as well as their cytotoxic effect. And with reference to my publication, the first one is still under internal review, and I've received a travel grant to present my work next month in Spain, and I've also received an additional research grant for my IFS. So I acknowledge my supervisor, and thank you all for listening.
Thank you very much.